Hi, everyone. It's January 5th, 2017, and this is the very first show of this brand new year of Quantum Healing with Candace. And today I'm welcoming back a very good friend of mine, Katya Turner. Actually, welcoming back is kind of a funny thing to say. First time on this show, but she was on a previous show I used to have, but Katya and I go way back. So Katya is an intuitive empath, a starseed activator, an author, and a teacher. She was born very psychic and tuned in a very unconscious USSR. That's right, folks. She is from way over there. And from time, you know, she learned how to suppress her gifts and abilities as they were setting her apart as different, weird, and broken. And she sounds like a lot of us out here, right? So for the sake of love and acceptance, she dove deep into the world of ego, achievement, and illusion to be awakened in 2012 with a string of intense, unexplainable experiences. And when her ascension process kicked in hard in 2015, it was so intense, she was determined to share her breakthroughs and insight with others. And this is how Indigo Diaries was born. First, a trilogy about her life as an indigo, and later a thriving blog where she shares what she learns along the path of awakening and channeled guidance from her guides and other multidimensional friends. She offers intuitive sessions, hosts live calls called purpose calls, which are designed to help people find their purpose even from the darkest places. And while a teacher, she is more so a student along with everyone awakening, who is very passionate about sharing her knowledge and breakthroughs, her stories and sessions, in hopes to be your friend through this intense but beautiful process that is ascension into your true self. Welcome, Katya. It is so great to talk to you again.
It is so great to be here, Candace. I cannot believe that we are a little over a year from the last time that we talked, and so much has changed. And I have changed so much, and I'm sure you have changed so much. Wow.
Yes. There's been so much that has happened. So to recap just a little bit, I guess it was spring of last year, I had Katya on my New Earth Journey show when I used to have a show on BBS Radio. And I had that show for about a year and then let it go because this one came along with a greater audience and more opportunity to reach people. But you and I talked at the time about your project at the time, which was about motherhood. You want to remind everyone what that was about?
So I had a platform that was all about natural birth and an inspired pregnancy. I was so passionate after my own pregnancy with my daughter, and it was very high vibrational pregnancy that has taught me a lot. And so, and I wanted to share it all with people. I wanted people not to be afraid of birth and trust their bodies and stuff like that. And if I had all of that inside of me, I wanted to share it, wrote a book, made a website. And yes, that's what we talked about back then.
And it was such a beautiful gift, really. I mean, you made so much available to other mothers out there. You felt very strongly about it being a gift, very generous, just giving the message out there and really making a connection with other young mothers and mothers-to-be across the planet.
And you know what? Now, from the mountain on which I am right now, what I understand about that was, and it was such a gift that right now, and such a huge message that I'm sharing now, was that that project was more so for me to open up this channel of sharing, because I've always felt, and more so in like 2013 and onward, this huge energy and message within me that needed to get out. But just like so many people out there, especially right now in 2017, are sitting there like, I don't even know where to start. Where do I even begin? So back then I was still pregnant and I was like, I don't know where to start. So, okay, what can I talk about right now? Well, this amazing experience, I have stuff to say. So why not say it? It's going to be something, because I'm very conscious of my like energy body and how I feel with it coming through me. And it's like when the energy is here, but it's not getting out, it's trapped like right about there. So I can't exist like that. That was goes out. It's like, well, I have a message now. I never in the world thought I would be doing anything about pregnancy, motherhood, birth, anything like that, but it had to come out, and it came out in a beautiful way. It's a beautiful gift for so many people out there who are in the same place that I was back then, because it was so hard to find resources all in one place. Actually, there was no one place for all of those resources. So beautiful stuff ended up, you know, as a benefit win-win for everybody. And it definitely kicked me into the gear of what I'm doing right now.
And you know, that's so special, really, because a lot of times mothers are so overwhelmed with motherhood, and, you know, and kudos to them too, to sort of sometimes, you know, hibernate and really nest with their young ones. But somehow with this, you know, very small child, you have just gone poo into the universe and gotten even bigger, and your energy is just exploding. Let's back all the way up. Can you tell us a little bit, what I'd like to know is a little bit about how you even got to America? I mean, you started off in USSR, and how you got to America, and then, you know, how you met Cherokee, how you got to Arkansas, because you and I met with working with Dolores Cannon, and we've got a lot of things to talk about and reminisce about as far as, you know, being in the world of Dolores. But tell everyone kind of how you even got here, what your early life was like. I know a little bit about it, but I'd love for you to share with some of our listeners, you know, kind of how did you get yourself over here?
So I was born, it was still USSR, and in about 4 years, it became Ukraine, and the surroundings were off the hook. And so why they were off the hook is because also I was born as a master. I looked at everything from a vastly different perspective. I looked through people, through society. I mean, my perception as a baby, was like, what are these people doing? Like, I don't understand this game they're playing. Like, don't they get it? Like, I saw people put on these masks that they felt very, I don't know, good carrying, because the society, or the party rather, back then, it gave you these little like templates of human you could be. And everybody was putting on those little masks and being fitting in those little templates, absolutely disregarding anything within themselves. And I looked at it all, and I remember I decided, it was a conscious decision of me as a child, as a very, very young child, of me not to really even open my mouth, because I looked at my parents, and they were like the, you know, the closest of what society represented to me. And I knew that if I were to tell them that they were living a big, big illusion, I would shatter their world, especially with the fact that I had a very, I don't know, like direct view at it. So, and up until now, I can't really edit myself to be nice much. So, like, I knew that it would shatter their world, because they couldn't comprehend even why certain things were happening in their life, how it's all connected to alignment or misalignment within the cells. Like, the concept of self didn't exist there. So, yeah, a little bit later, as I started kind of being more interactive, right, with my family, I started realizing real fast that how I was very, very broken, because I kept hearing things like, you're too sensitive, you need to toughen up, you're too serious, you're too silly. And I was like, I remember this process. Now I'm so thankful to this like crazy awakening that happened in 2016, because it made me actually remember the feeling that I had as a child, and like the thought process of this confusion of why am I not all right as I am? But as a human still, who wants love and appreciation and affection, right? I was like, okay, so if I want to be loved, I need to be A, B, C, and D, all of these things that my parents are telling me I need to be. And then came school, more things added up to the list, and then TV and more things. And as, you know, we spread out into society, we figure out all of these things that, okay, now we need to be thin. Now we need to speak 5 languages. Now we need to have 3 diplomas. Now we need to have this kind of skin, this kind of hair. I mean, you name it. And that's what I did. I really, really, truly believe that I was very broken. Because I could see visions from the very early childhood, communicated with things outside of these dimensions, And I always thought that I was not there, honestly, all the way up until I met you, actually. Like, actually, it was a phrase that came out of your mouth that made me, like, lose it and click for me. Wow. And it was during a, I think, QHHT practitioner reunion, but we're going to get there. And so yeah, I lived in that kind of state for years, and I got really good at this game, right, of what society wants me to be. I got really good at achieving things. I was the best at every single thing I was putting my hands on. And partially it was because I was genuinely talented and I loved doing a lot of those things that I have put myself to do. But mainly, again, now realizing after 2016, it was all driven by wanting to fit in, by wanting to be accepted, by wanting to be loved. And I understood that those were the conditions. So I lived like that. And I remember my parents, my mom left to Italy when I was, I think, 9 years old to make money because Ukraine didn't offer much to musicians. And I lived with my dad, who had a pretty good problem with alcohol. So that was a whole another story. And then he left whenever I was 17. So I started living on my own there, going to the university. They trusted me. And to me, honestly, it was like, I don't need to parent anybody anymore.
Right.
That was a real kind of relief. So they left. I was like, finally freedom. And as I was in the university there, and I've always had this dream of, I always knew I was going to go to that university, a linguistic university. I wanted to be an interpreter. And I got that position after my first year of school, after my first year. I got to translate a TV show for a very prominent TV channel there in Ukraine. And I realized that A, doesn't pay very well. B, I got it. Now what? Like, I'm not going to do this for the rest of my life. That's not interesting. Then I knew I was a really good writer. And my half brother he used to be this head of a information agency back in Kiev. And so he's like, yeah, you're really good. I can get you into any publication. At that point, it was like, well, no challenge, not interesting. What do we do? And this opportunity came up to go to the States. And here's how it was decided. It was me and my roommate sitting in my kitchen and drinking tea and thinking, why don't we go? Like, yeah, probably. Pause for about 10 seconds. Like, why don't we go and why don't we stay? And that's it. I'm like, yep, we're going to do it. And we did it. And despite, you know, my parents, I remember, didn't even come to like farewell me on the plane because they were convinced I was going to come back and there was no coming back. So it was a big lesson for them. But then for me, I remember I felt such a strong alignment to, I knew that this was going to be the next step. And I just knew it and I did it. And thank God there was no people around me to talk me out of it much. Although people tried who were there, but it was absolutely irrelevant. And whenever we come to the States, I worked a bunch of different jobs up until I decided, okay, this no longer is a sustainable thing. I want to go to college. And when I was picking what I wanted to go to college for, I decided to go with what my hobby was, which at that point it was photography. I've always wanted to do it, and I did it because I was bored pretty much in Branson. And yeah, so I went to college for graphic design, and I realized I was really good, went to competitions, during competition met my husband Cherokee. And it was a very interesting time in my life because I thought I had figured it all out. Like, I thought I had life finally figured out. Especially the breaking point for me was I was just out of this really weird rebound relationship for that lasted like for a year, and it was so bad, and I knew it was bad. And I got to the point where all my life I was very afraid of being alone. And at that point I was like, you know what, I'm just now like starting a business, I'm like thriving at everything, so I'm like, I'm gonna be alone. And then I'm going to enjoy it. And I started actually enjoying it. And I'm like, yes, Katya has figured life out. And then as soon as I met Cherokee, ascension kicked in. And it was crazy tornado roller coaster. And it started off with us getting pregnant in the first month of us being together, which for both of us was like, and we ended up getting an abortion done back then, which was in itself a crazy experience. through which we bonded a lot. And then as all of that was going on, the craziest ascension symptoms started happening to me. Like, I was absolutely always in the sense of vertigo. Like, I just got off of a roller coaster. I had these like electricity jolts throughout my body to where I didn't know, was I having a heart attack? Was I having a panic attack? Was I having a stroke? Like, I don't know. And nothing there to explain it. I was constantly in the state of like doom and fear, anxiety. I don't know. All of it was very, very physical and absolutely unexplainable, to where a lot of the times I was going to bed and I was like, I don't know if I'm going to wake up or not, but let's see. And then one day we saw a UFO in the midst of all of this crazy goes on. I have no idea what this is.
And where were you at the time?
It was Cherokee's birthday. It was my husband's birthday. We were driving from a casino back home. It was like 5 a.m. And we saw this light in the sky that was doing very, very odd things. We thought it was like a police helicopter searching for somebody, but it wasn't, because it was moving too fast. It couldn't maneuver that fast, the helicopter. And then it just crossed the road right in front of us. And there was no denying that. And man, holy goosebumps again. I love this story. There was no denying it was a UFO. And I think it was the next day that Cherokee remembered that he went to school with Travis and Shonda, who are relatives of Dolores Cannon. He remembered about Dolores Cannon. He's like, oh my gosh, she's from my hometown. I need to message them. I need to get a regression done, because I'm pretty sure that I've had contact.
Now, what year was all of this happening?
I believe 2013. But right now, honestly, looking back,
right,
the time being so weird and fluid, back, and I can barely pinpoint.
Right.
So I think it was 2013. And so he reached out to Shonda, and I remember she replied like, well, Dolores has like a 7-year waiting list. And okay, we got her books. We started reading Convoluted Universe, and we left to Italy, and we were kind of like thinking about it. And as soon as we came back from Italy, we got a message from Shonda like, hey, Cherokee, will you produce a couple conferences for us? And he is a video producer. So that's how that got us to working with Dolores. And then so Cherokee started working with a company, and then slowly I started working with them as well, starting out doing photography during those events just because I was there anyway. And yes. And so I remember at first we did UFO conference, and that was very interesting. And I remember that's the time I first seen the word ascension. Like, it was some sign, I think, about transformation conference. And it had the word ascension. I'm like, what is that? Interesting. But I wasn't really, really conscious about what was going on with me up and still. And then the next conference was the transformation. And we did that practitioner reunion beforehand. And I remember you talking on stage. Honestly, I will never forget that moment. Whenever you were talking about how number two can have a feeling and a taste, and some other number can have like, you know, a feeling and a texture. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm not crazy. Like, there's other people in the world who see the world the way I do. It's like, I am literally not crazy. Like, that was the moment. It was kind of like a bucket of water was dumped over me. I was like, wow.
You never told me this before. That's synesthesia, in case anybody out there is unfamiliar with it. It's when people can, feel a texture or a taste or a smell with something like a number, which, mm-hmm. you know, to most people, that doesn't make any sense. And I have to say, I'm familiar with that. I get that in waves. I don't have it all the time, mm-hmm. but that's pretty interesting.
Yes. So that was the moment when it was like a moment of my conscious awakening, because after that, I came home and it was like frantically looking stuff up. Like, that's when the conscious part started happening. And I was looking it up for months and months and months. And then I found a book by Nikki Patillo, Children of the Stars, which explained a lot. Because I thought, oh, these indigo children, like, I always thought about this term. But to me, they're like, well, they are the psychic ones. They're the gifted ones. They're the connected ones. I'm like, I'm nothing like that. I'm this broken, weird thing, right? And then I went through the checklist in her book and I got like 20 out of 21. I'm like, holy moly. And everything I see, and it took me a little bit to understand that everything I see and the visions and the feelings are actually gifts, and that I am actually way connected and way tapped in. But it took me a little bit to kind of get there. Yeah, so it was huge. It was a huge pivotal moment then, whenever I went from really thinking genuinely that I was broken in the core of my being somewhere to, whoa, like, I'm not. So there must be some explanation for all of this. And then I started searching, started looking. And yeah, then I got pregnant, had an amazing, super high vibrational pregnancy with my little starseed child. Wow. That now explains so much, now in my deeper understanding of generally everything. And after that, I started the platform I Was Made to Do This. And in the midst of that, my dark night of the soul kicked in. And it was so dark and so intense that I was sitting one day and thinking, well, maybe, just maybe, if I found a way to raise my vibration just a little bit, maybe it would be easier. And the first thought that came to mind was, well, and it was instant, like this vision came up of me driving in the car and a friend calling me. And they always, you know, have some problems or something that they want to discuss with me. And I always knew what to say. Not only that, it made me feel so alive, like telling them stuff. Like I always had answers. I'm like, wow, this is the easiest way to get there. So I'm like, why don't I open like a Q&A column on my site to where people can email me questions? And I always know I will have the answer, and it will give me like a really good feeling to give that answer to them. And then that same day in meditation, I hear, offer private sessions. I'm like, maybe this can be a private session thing. Okay. But then I clearly got a message like, seek guidance. At which point I booked a session with Andrew. And if anybody doesn't know, Andrew at delightedones.com is who I'm referencing. And he says, well, no, you're being called to do what I do. I'm like, what do you mean? I don't know how to do that. Like, hence I'm here. Like, we're talking every month, crazy stuff going on. Like, I don't know how to do this. So he's like, okay, let me ask your higher self. And the higher self says, clarity comes in the process. So beautiful. Here I was like, I have no idea how to do this. But the only clue I had was like, well, all my life, I was kind of a person who, like, I could come up to a desk, put my hand on the desk, and know everything about this desk for you. Who made it? What their lives were like? I mean, everything. Where the trees grew, kind of deal. If I wanted to get that information. And I was like, well, it's either that, or I'm not going to do it, because I don't understand any other way of doing it. And I booked a session with a friend of mine who was, like, my best friend for almost 9 years. I trusted him with everything. And we got on Skype, and I remember the level of fear I had, like the level of being exposed kind of deal. Holy moly. I literally physically felt like I was falling, and I was waiting for somebody to catch me. But I'm like, I don't know, just start talking and I'm going to tell you what comes. And we did that. And I instantly started getting some insight, some guidance and whatnot. And, I decided, okay, this is probably a viable thing. At which point I found a group of already conscious people somewhat. And I posted there like, well, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm clearly being called to do this. So if you all need any guidance, call me. And they started calling. And I was absolutely astounded by the level of energy that was coming through me in sessions, by the diversity of all the things that I could do psychically and energetically and otherwise. And eventually I kind of got to pick what out of all of this I actually wanted to do, because like there was a lot of like energy healing coming through, and it was beautiful and super profound, like super profound, but I just wasn't into it. Like I just, that's it. And I remember even back then, my biggest kind of passion was connecting people to their purpose. And somehow really to how that works. And I enjoyed that the most. And no wonder right now I'm hosting these purpose calls. It's so easy. This energy is coming through and it's mind blowing. But that was like, wow, like that story that got me from, you know, where I was this fully awakened master kid. Like, I remember how it used to be that kid. I'm still nowhere near there. Like, I'm still working my way up to having that power and that kind of alignment, to forgetting it all, absolutely going into such a deep hole, and now like climbing out of it. And yeah, we did a lot of climb in 2016, which we still have, you know, a whole lot to go, but wow, what a journey.
It's kind of amazing that, you know, you had all of this happening while being in the realm and being in the midst of the world of Dolores Cannon. You know, all of the things that she was exposed to, all of the ideas that she shared with people, and the fact that you and Cherokee got to work with her. And, you know, I have to tell you, because, you know, we've done projects together, and we've got more to do, you know. I mean, we are already talking about doing more things. But one of the things that I just love about what you've done and were able to do was, as far as I know, you captured the only professional photographs of Dolores Cannon that exist, literally. And I would tell a quick story. So I actually was a pro photographer before coming to this work of quantum healing. And it took me a while to gather up the courage to ask, but I finally did ask if I could bring my professional equipment to one of Dolores's classes in 2012. Now, Dolores was an absolute dream about cell phone pictures and grip and grin pictures. She was great, but she had the strongest camera radar of anybody that I know, anybody. And photographers out there know what I'm talking about. So they said, okay, you can bring your camera to this class. And it was one, you know, one of the earlier classes where I was assisting back in, I think, 2012. And so I stopped what I was doing for a little while assisting with the class. And I went out and got my camera. And I just wanted to, you know, my thought was, I really was so interested in Dolores's legacy, as I still am. I mean, I still run her original support forum, still very interested in her legacy. I don't even know if you know this, Katya, but we actually, our group, Dolores's original support forum community, we're indexing her entire work, her entire volumes. We're indexing the subject matter. So when people have been coming to us for years and asking things like, you know, latest question I got was, did she say anything about RH values in blood? You know, and what we're doing is now indexing her entire work so we can go and look at that. Yeah. But I brought my camera out into this class, and I'm thinking, you know, some casual shots of her in teaching mode and everything. Every time my finger got on the shutter button, she'd look at me like this. She didn't like it. She didn't, I mean, I didn't, I, you know, back then they were the bigger, I had the big camera, so I was far away from her. I wasn't up in her face at all. And it didn't matter. I mean, I was behind other people's heads trying to get, I put that camera away pretty quickly. And I thought, you know what? She doesn't want a photo like that taken. It's, even though we talked about it, and it was part of the plan, I just said, forget it. It's just not going to happen. You're going to have cell phone photos for the rest of your life. But you got her in like a studio setting with lights and a camera. And those are the photos now that circle the world. Your photographs of Dolores Cannon. I think that's amazing. And then at the same time, Cherokee is doing these really great videos where she's wearing that blue shirt with the little white tie thing, and she's talking about her work. And those videos just keep being seen by more and more people all the time.
Yeah. It was a very interesting time.
Yeah.
I definitely believe none of it was by accident, and a lot of it was energy and why it had to happen like that. But I mean, we definitely enjoyed our time with Dolores, and how much of a forward propeller for us she was and her work was, it's absolutely astounding. I mean, I remember during my first pregnancy, I was glued to convoluted universe, trying to find like stuff about the new children, right? What kind of energy they got. I remember reading about births, right? How do they see births and stuff like that. Very interesting. Very interesting.
So amazing that you'd be, you know, reading that, and as you're thinking those thoughts, you know, your child is in your womb and experiencing that. And you and I and Cherokee had a special exploration using quantum healing together, didn't we? And you know, you, at the time, it was so profound, and I really never talked about it, of course, really with anybody. I didn't talk about it even on our forum abstractly, because you know, it was so intense and it was so private. But now you shared with me that you've actually talked about it publicly. So I'm so thrilled about that, because now that means we can talk about it a little bit. Would you share with our audience a little bit about what we did and what that was like for you? And guess what? I actually brought my session notes. I have my session notes here, and I don't know if you listened to the recording or what you think about it now, but I know that our audience would love to hear about what happened.
I would love to re-listen to the recording, because I remember the energy that I was in. Wow, because it was absolutely not my energy. It was the energy of my child. And back with that pregnancy, the general like vibration of that pregnancy was so high. Like, I pretty much got to experience what it would be like to be ascended, what it would be like to have a crystalline body, what it would be like to be of that high vibrational energy. And then after she was born, like 3 months later, my vibration dropped to my original one, and dark night of the soul. And they're like, and now you get to do this on your own. But what the session was about, so we did a double regression, right? Both me and my husband went under. And I am amazed at that experience for, I guess, my own selfish reasons, because I'm just like mad scientist trying to figure this out.
Because I'm going to stop you for a moment just to say, when Katya is talking about a double session, what she's really saying, or what I'd like to expand about just for a second, it was a tandem session. So Katya and Cherokee had a session, but at the exact same time. They laid side by side on the bed in my wellness studio, and they both went under hypnosis at the same time. Now continue.
And here's an interesting point too. So how people usually go under, which is how Cherokee goes under, is under. Like, they experience it, like how he describes it, as this like IMAX vision opens up, and he sees it very vividly, very in his face. And then when his higher self comes in, he just releases the body pretty much to the higher self to speak. So that's his experience of it. My experience of it, and this has been every single QHHT session I've ever had, although now it would be interesting to try again because of the level of connection now. But I am in that state the majority of my day. So when I close my eyes, it's that. I don't go any deeper, anything. It's just that. Whether I meditate or I call it a QHHT session, like, it's just the same for me. So the experience itself was crazy. And here's why. Because we could see the same things. We could experience the same things with him being under. And me pretty much not. And me just laying there with my eyes closed. Which is a huge point of my research now, is the telepathy part. And that's right there is a physical proof for you that it's there. We're just not using it. The same thing happened once in this meditation I have guided Andrew through. Me and Andrew had a session back when I just started out doing my intuitive sessions. And a part of this channeling that came through for him was that I am to guide him through this visualization. And as I did it, I was kind of under myself, right? I was in that space. The same thing happened. He's sitting there in Seattle. I'm sitting here in Arkansas, both eyes closed. We are navigating the same space. And he's like, oh, look up. You see that thing? I'm like, yes, I totally see that thing. Look what she's doing. Yes, absolutely. Which is
the definition of quantum, right? The definition of quantum entanglement.
Mm-hmm. So it was like, I'm still putting two and two together to be able to explain it to people easy, right? But that is just such an illustration of the fact that we are so connected, so tipped in. We can use it every day, but we just don't, just because we're so focused on our secondary reality, on our physical reality here.
Right. So interesting. What I loved about it so much was that you finished each other's sentences. I mean, it was so astonishing. And I know, you know, the audience probably want to know a little bit about where you were, some of the things that you saw, but they would talk to each other. They both had their eyes closed and one would say, do you see the, and the other one would finish the sentence. Yes, there's a great big, you know, and then they just, it was kind of amazing. And the energy was so intense. And I even know because of the way that I wrote these notes, because I kind of drifted off myself, you know, mm-hmm. And I know, you know what that's like.
Yeah.
Because when you actually do these sessions and you sit in these sessions, you get carried along with that. And even if you're the facilitator, you're still connected to your higher self or your whole self, and you're connected. You're having some of this experience as well. And, you know, I can tell because I start off with a kind of handwriting and I'm pretty, you know, I have some pretty good sentences. And then towards the end, I just, wow. And do you remember this part? Because I don't know, do you mind me kind of like showing this? Cherokee in the middle of the session drew.
Yeah.
Can I show that?
Please. Yeah.
So this is one of the notes in the session. And Cherokee drew this. And do you remember what he said it was?
No, I don't.
Yeah, I'm gonna throw on my reading glasses to see, but yeah. Cherokee sits up. So that symbol, he said, was his name. This is okay. His name in a symbol.
Yeah.
And that happens in sessions. Occasionally people will, even in the middle, and Dolores did this too, see things, want to show a building or a symbol or whatever. But the astonishing thing was, I think the symbol just like showed up for both of you to see. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're like both seeing like this symbol and you're like, and I'm not quite seeing it. And that's when I said, well, can you draw it? And he's like, yes. And he sits up from a very deep trance and takes my pen and he drew that and then laid back down and you all finished the session.
Yeah. He drew so many things after that in sessions. Like whenever I would regress him, he would get up. Sometimes he would draw a being that was coming through. Like instead of his higher self, we would tap into something else, or somebody else would come through to talk to us and he would draw the being. Like this is what it looks like, what we're talking to. Or yeah, more symbols, mostly symbols.
Yeah. Wow. You know, I was looking for it a little while ago. I almost wore a t-shirt today because it had an Ancient Aliens, the guy where it says, the fella says, well, I'm not saying it was aliens, but it was aliens. The t-shirt, and somehow I ran across that t-shirt today. And part of me thought, I bet I could wear that and it would match for tonight's show. I'm sure we'll end up talking about aliens, but really we're talking about multidimensional or off planet or other dimensional beings. And I really don't like the term aliens anymore. not so much anyway, but you had this session while you were carrying your first child.
Yes. And this is a very interesting experience because as I've researched more, I've understood.
So there's really three of you in the session, plus me.
I understood that this is a process, and we went through like a deep process of chakra realignment in a way. We went through these, like, we were swimming in colors, like or ponds of different color, and then the fireworks of another color. So like it was a energy realignment before we could bring in this child here as a parental unit. We had to go through that. I'm so very curious how other people get to experience it. Because for us, it was like an amazing ride of a double regression. You know, it was so cool. But not every parent of a child that's a new kind of earth being gets to experience that. But it's definitely a very common thing, from what I understand, of what parents have to go through.
Yeah, your pregnancy was so interesting. And one of the things that I remember most about it was, and we asked, this is one of the questions we asked, I remember vividly, we asked one of these questions for your higher self in this session about, at the time, I mean, you're pregnant and you were eating like fruit and more fruit and then with a side of fruit. right? I mean, yeah. You existed on fruit during that pregnancy, and you were absolutely in the heart of yourself, sure that this was fine for the health of your child, mm-hmm. and your higher self agreed, and you have this beautiful, I mean, your entire pregnancy was perfect and beautiful, and your child is healthy and well, and you've learned so much, and you followed your heart, and that's kind of what your whole I was made to do this platform is all about, because this, you know what, I'm buzzing as I'm saying all that now too, because it was so beautiful that you didn't do the thing where you looked up the books and like force yourself to eat, I don't know, eggs or meat or something that, you know, you couldn't deal with. You were listening to your own body, and your own body was saying something that was off the charts, not what the experts say, yeah. right? The experts would tell you that you would have been endangering maybe not only, you know, your baby's life, but yours with a diet mm-hmm. like that. But it turned yeah. out
exactly. And especially to go vegan in the middle of pregnancy. To
exactly.
go from meat, from smoking, you know, and doing all of the drinking Coke and all of that to fruit and water.
I know.
Yeah.
I remember
and
that.
Absolutely beautiful. I felt like I was reborn. But here's the deal. And my latest session with Cherokee and his higher self conversation explains a lot of it, was whenever we are talking about a crystalline body, and that's what I was carrying, it's way more about the energy and the vibration that you hold than the actual food you put into your body. The ratio of what matters, it's like 90 to 10. Like, yeah, your body is still a 3D body and it still needs certain nutrients and stuff, which you still can get from all plant-based food. Now that vegan movement is like booming out, we're kind of starting to realize that we can eat absolutely healthy on just plant-based. But the vibration was a lot of it. And you said the ease with which I was able to stick to that, absolutely now understand. I cannot attribute it to myself. It was that mastery that my child held. And I am just now getting close to that kind of level of mastery within myself and kind of figuring out how that works. And I talk about it in one of my videos on how to manifest, right? Because it's an essence of what we did there, is to hold your focus so tightly on this thing that in this other video I saw, which kind of speaks to my heart so loudly, it's called quantum superposition. You put the one outcome as a quantum superposition. The outcome of a healthy, happy child was my program. And I was able to hold that program so easily with the help of her energy and her focus, to the point where if my mind would say something like, oh, what if, blah, blah, it was like, nope. What if, nope. So that all of the other possibilities did not enter the space. They were never given a chance to develop energetically. So they didn't. And against all physical proof odds, right? We had a healthy, happy child, an amazing pregnancy when I felt amazing. And yeah, and it all turned out to be fine and some. So she taught me a lot with that experience, a whole lot, to where like now kind of having tasted the end result of being of that kind of that level of mastery, of that level of vibration. Now I know where to aim and I'm figuring out how to get myself there from a place of lower vibration to a place of that. And that's what I'm kind of sharing with people a lot on my channel on the side.
How is your child doing and how old is she right now?
She's almost 21 months right now, and she's doing amazing. Very interesting to see. She's starting to talk a little bit here and a little bit there. She is very willful, she knows what she wants. She knows her alignment, and it's beautiful to witness, beautiful. And I cannot wait until she starts talking, until we can discuss all of it, because I know she's way extrasensory. She sees way more things than we do. I mean, it's not surprising to me. I knew it was going to be that way.
Do you telepathically communicate?
Here's how it's interesting. Yes. But that telepathy doesn't, it's not like, I guess, what we would consider a regular telepathy. There's no images, there's no words. It's a communication through vibration.
Yes.
Through feeling, right? To where we don't need to translate it into words, into anything more physical than what it already is. So yeah, that's definitely going on.
And you're expecting another one, aren't you?
Yes. And this pregnancy was very, very, very different from the other one, because during this pregnancy, I have absolutely no access to the energy of the child. And
really,
I have experienced the craziest dark night of the soul with absolutely wild ascension symptoms as a byproduct of it, to where sometimes I stopped and I'm like, are you guys out of your mind? Because like, sometimes I'm like, I can't eat for a week, let's say. Like if my solar plexus and my sacral chakra are going through some upgrade, I cannot eat for a week. Like my whole energetic system gets rebooted along with the physical system. And it was just crazy things are going on. And the level of vibration, imagine going through the dark night of the soul, where kind of the level of lows that you're in is absolutely astounding. Yes, yeah, so very, very interesting to compare the two. And in this pregnancy, I knew it was like, well, I'm on my own here. Like I have to figure it out with my own vibration, with my own tools. And hence, so many blogs, so many videos came out of this process as a byproduct of me kind of figuring it out slowly.
And you had a home birth the first time. Are you planning on doing that again?
Yes.
Of course you are. And kudos to you. And I can't wait to hear about how it all turns out this next time.
Yes, me too. I'm so curious because this time is definitely all unknown.
Right.
Fully unknown.
How exciting.
But again, the level of unknown is only until we know it to be something.
So we're coming into 2017 in a way that, you know, it's funny. We as helpers and as guides, way showers doing this kind of thing, I've been thinking about that as you've been speaking. And so just like the book that Nikki wrote that you said, you know, the start, and you read the list and you were like, oh my gosh, and you recognized yourself there. And then you met up with Andrew, and then Andrew had actually a QHHT session with a colleague of mine, Aurelian Rado, and wrote an article that's on our practitioner blog. And there's all these connections, and some of you out there are having some of these kinds of events happen in your life too. And I wanted to just say this. There's so many more people needed to help other people wake up. People are on different levels. They hear different things. They hear somebody say something, a phrase like, I didn't even know that I did that, you know, in your world when I was talking about synesthesia. But if you have this hunger and desire in you to speak about these things, it's part of, you know, source energy telling you that your purpose, you know, may not be to quit your job or anything, but to actually speak to people about this and not have any fear about that and connect with others, because it really does help other people. And like in your introduction, I just loved it so much. You know, I think that you and I and others like us coming up along in this year of 2017, you know, we're past this guru stage. You know, we're past the one person handing down the tablets, you know, carved in stone that they know something and that they're offering it to you, because it's in here. This is where it is. You know, it's in here, and this is where you need to start it. But by sharing what's in here, other people then begin to listen, and they listen to what's in here. And it's so beautiful how that's happening in 2017, and these connections with you, with Andrew, with Aurelian, and then suddenly, like, you know, I mean, I knew you were working on stuff, but all of a sudden you just like exploded onto the scene, and like the connections, like it's like the circuit connected here. And here we are talking about this, and suddenly we're back to doing more projects together, planning things, more things to do together to help others and bring others into the fold. And how much easier that is in this year, right? 2017. I mean, the simple fact that you're even doing what you're doing, talking to me about taking on these projects, you have a toddler and you're about ready to give birth, and yet you're like, yeah, let's do that.
My project wall is full, so that you can understand. Oh my gosh, I just talked about this in my recent videos about how I watched my husband like blossom and say yes to every single one opportunity. And I'm like, wow, this life that I've always thought that I was going to be living is right here for me.
Yes.
It's about me saying yes and actually doing it. And it's such a big message right now in the world of taking action and actually showing up for these ideas, because we have been through like a meat grinder just now, but all of us who have, all of us are sitting with these ideas in our field, whether we realize it or not, whether we have put our finger on them, on those thoughts or not. Some of us are more tapped into how we speak to our guidance. Some of us are less, but those things are coming up for everybody. And it's all about like, will you say yes to them? Will you say yes to your soul coming through you?
Yeah. Yeah. Some of my clients recently have been saying, and I'm sure you probably have gotten the same thing, and they say, you know, I'm so excited about these things and I'm so hungry to talk about them, but I'm afraid other people will think I'm weird. And because they're afraid that they won't be understood and they won't be accepted and they won't be loved. You know, we're talking about exactly what your entire childhood was about, you know, what partially mine was about too. Just don't talk about that, you know, stay in the accepted norms and everything. But we're moving out of that in a really big way. And to deny that in you not only keeps you from your joy, but it can turn around and kind of fester inside of you with incorrect energy and possibly even manifest as illness.
Yes, I see this manifesting as illness in people over and over and over again. And every time, whenever people ask me like, well, what do I do if I know I have the ideas, but I'm not getting them out? I'm like, well, blockages is what happens. Like you feel first just heavy, and then you start manifesting physical stuff in that area that's heavy. It's plain and simple. So yeah, it's so big right now. And I feel like it's a very natural process of what we went through last year. And, you know, we go through this in waves, and people are going to be going to deeper and deeper extents of that. When we realize within ourselves that we do not need acceptance and love of others to be happy, when we reparent ourselves fully and have that relationship with our inner child and the relationship with our inner essence, right, to where we are whole within ourselves, we don't need anybody else's approval. We realize that their reactions are a byproduct of their own energy system and their own past and their own lessons that are coming up. Then we free ourselves to do whatever and to say whatever and to just show up for our calling, and that's it. And if it stirs up the waves, well, guess what, we came here to make those waves. We came here to be exactly that, the catalyst for change in others. And yeah, a lot of us had to do what I did, dive deep into the, you know, the ego and the illusion just to be able to climb out of it and teach others how to climb out of there. But in essence, right now is the time why we came. Like they keep showing this to me and keep repeating this, that all this time you have been preparing and collecting experiences and collecting knowledge for now. Mm-hmm. Like now is the time to act. You have come here to live now.
Mm-hmm. You know, I'm looking down at some notes that I wrote, because I'm opening up more and more to my own guides and guidance. And, you know, the person who leads my team is my mentor, my teacher, our beautiful friend, Dolores Cannon. And she talked, she was talking about 2017, and she was, one of the phrases she wrote in what I wrote here was, she says, stop doing everything later, do it now.
Yes.
You know, 2017 is the year of doing it now. You know, it's some sort of, I'm actually, do you mind? I would like to read this. Yeah. So I hear Dolores best in the morning, and I actually asked if she had a message for people regarding the new year of 2017. And she said, yes, she said, there's still a lot of work to do. And then she starts by saying, there's this peculiar human trait so many of you have. Let's call it the I'll do it later trait. You have good intentions, positive goals, and kind hearts. And then you slap the I'll do it later trait on top of those intentions, and it is like throwing a bucket of cold water on a beautiful little campfire. Stop doing it later. Do it now. The year of 2017 is the year of creation and of doing it now rather than doing it later, and you really are running out of time. You had many years and many lifetimes of opportunities, and it's really coming down to the wire, and you need to do it now. And then, so people might ask, well, do what? Well, she says, some of you are writing. Good, just keep at it. And finish it up and get it out there for others to read. You may think you need to reach perfection before publication, and that's not so important. Get a good editor, use spell check, and just publish it. And then she reminds us and me, she carried manuscripts around for years, waiting for an opportunity to publish her first book. And as many of you know, she continues, she ended up creating her own publishing company because of the lack of opportunity and interest in her regression work from the big publishing houses. She says, none of you face this obstacle. You can self-publish. So do it. And some of you have other projects, art, music, therapy, or community-based ideas that focus on love, acceptance, and helping other people. Some projects are very small and one-on-one. Maybe you've even considered volunteering at an old folks' home. I love that she said old folks home. I hadn't heard the phrase old folks home in a really long time. Or women's shelter. Just go do it. Even if you can only help a few times or very occasionally, stop waiting. Some of you have grand ideas, classes, businesses, or even producing movies. Like us, Cherokee.
Right.
Do the See the Red Bird movies. We're gonna. Yep. I can't wait to start on those, you know? Maybe you've even, I already said that. Just do it. Don't let the largeness of the project idea overwhelm you. Small bites, small pieces, just keep moving forward. Every day is filled with 15-minute blocks of time you can use to grow your project, whatever it is. And then she said, I used to read and write and even edit books while eating dinner on a TV tray and watching Matlock. I had to look up what Matlock was. It's a detective show. Uh-huh. Andy Griffith. And didn't Andy Griffith have like a Arkansas? I think it was in Arkansas, the Andy Griffith show. Anyway, so she's talking about that. She says, it's amazing what you can accomplish in the space of time during even a set of commercials. You don't have to lock yourself in a room or take yourself off to Fiji to write or create. The world in 2017 needs each of you to step into the gifts you have to bring and fulfill the reason for your life right now. If you are feeling a yearning, that is your subconscious and your soul reminding you of your purpose. 2017 is about facing your purpose square on and getting on with it. Thank you for letting me share that with you.
You know what I want to say? Just now it kind of hit me that, and it's something we talked about, like I am a walking example of what she's talking about, that 15-minute little spurts of time is yep. all that you need. You just need the freaking determination and saying yes and showing up. Like, yeah, who has a baby and writes like 4 different books at a time, creates 2 different websites, writes for freaking Collective Evolution, and then writes and writes and writes. Like right now I'm pumping out almost a blog a day, and they are not fluff, like they have a lot of substance to them. But how is that happening? It's happening by showing up and by saying yes. And I feel like a lot of people, they're waiting to become
yes
comfortable, and they're exactly. waiting for the circumstances to allow something. Well, the conviction and the pull is stronger than circumstances, and that's yes. it. And that is just, what are you showing up for? Are you showing up for sleep and to put off your life another year? Or are you going to show up for what it is that you're here to do? And let me tell you, the level of freedom and the level of this current of energy streaming through you that lets you feel such levels of like abundance and flow whenever you do show up for every single idea, even if it's not comfortable, even if it's 5 a.m. How many times I woke up at 5 a.m. to make like 11 different videos for my channel? because I know this is what I'm being called to do. That's it. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
Yeah.
It's all doable.
And that'll give you energy too. You know, if you're heading towards your purpose like that, you get energy to keep going. You just kind of have to step into it. And then it kind of takes you like a conveyor belt. You know, the room is actually sparkling. It's feeling so good, this connection that you and I are having right now. You know, the thing I want to say too is how amazing it is. How many people do you know that are talking about this? You know, I'm going to completely redo my website and my look this year. How many people have you heard say that? I'm doing it. You're doing it. And you're helping other people do it. And you and I are going to get together and offer like a little class or maybe a workshop about how people can do this. We're going to put together some steps and offer that out there. But this is the time of doing it. 2017 is the year of creation, probably and possibly the best year to create anything in our entire lives. I mean, it's like the pinnacle of the year to get going on whatever that is. I mean, you spend, many of you out there, way more times scrolling through Facebook, you know, those 15-minute blocks, that you could literally be doing these other things. And sometimes, what stops us, you know? What stops us? Well, it's fear, and then fear of failure, and then sometimes fear of success, too.
Mm-hmm. You know, well, yeah, I've had that. Oh, boy, yeah. I have that heart hit me
right. Hard. Yeah. But it's time. It's time to move forward and to get out there and get going. And, gosh, you know, having people like you out there to be able to help people find, you know, get on track and get on their purpose. And same with quantum healing, you know, getting into and having a session, very often it can help clarify or even bring some surprises to you about how or what you might think about doing in your future to sort of solidify all of these things and really live the life of your dreams and kind of stop doing things because you're supposed to, or you're told to, or you have to, or you think, you know, you're living in a drudgery. The time to leave the drudgery is now.
And people are feeling it, and people are going to keep feeling it. The beautiful, such a beautiful quality of this energy of 2017 is that it's going to make you so uncomfortable. Everybody's going to cross over into their purpose. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. It's just, what is the level of discomfort you're willing to take?
Yep.
And the discomfort grows fast. Like if we thought it was intense and not comfortable in 2016, the level of discomfort that's going to grow in 2017 is going to be huge and in your face and within seconds of not making a right decision. Yep. And so, it's all about that pretty much, you know, you either listen to your heart or take the discomfort, and then the discomfort is going to push you into that direction anyway. So,
so the thing that's different, tell me if you agree with this. So the thing that's different is in times past, you could put up with a situation that something wasn't correct about it. Maybe it was the incorrect job or a relationship or just a situation that didn't sit right with you, but you did it, you know, you went along with it for whatever reason, societal, family, you know, paying the bills, whatever it is, you went along with something that didn't quite sit right with you. You got a pass on that for time in years prior. This year, it's not going to be so easy to do that. Like Katya says that, you know, your discomfort, the line used to be, you know, pretty big. You could hang out on that line for a while and kind of figure out what you wanted to do and maybe this, maybe that. And the line has gotten much thinner now, and you know, you're gonna have to decide. You're gonna have to, it's either gonna explode in you or you need to explode out of there or something. But you know, the time of sort of sitting on all of that is over. But it's really, even if it's scary somehow to make those decisions or allow those things to come up, they're over with quickly. The whole thing is quick, right? So the discomfort comes up quick, the solutions or the possibilities show up quickly. You know, you choose one and then it resolves just as quickly. These years of languishing on whatever, or months and months of languishing, that seems to kind of be over.
Yes.
For a lot of things.
I feel like this is how and why we come in waves. And I see this over and over and over in my sessions, how much longer it was taking, like, to the waves before me, how much longer it was taking for them to learn the same lessons that it took for me. And then the lessons that it took me to learn, I don't know, 7 months, now people can accomplish in one meditation.
Exactly.
And here's what I think. Energetically, like I can see how it is, because we have gotten so many resources out there. Like, people have pumped up so much content, right, as a byproduct of this growth. So yeah, it's easy, easier. But also, what I feel is happening, right? I mean, as we literally are moving up in dimensions, it's like molecules are further apart. So everything is like looser. It's not that dense. Yes, it's so much easier and faster to shoot through the energy. So I can see how that's happening, and it's gonna keep happening. And I see this more and more, to where people are coming to me in sessions now and saying, well, I awakened like 2 months ago. And they are at my level. We are getting the same lessons.
Yes,
how is this possible?
Yes.
And I realized that, I've been learning here self-love for like 6 months and trying to figure out the ins and outs and bolts of it for myself. And this person right now, and again, more of it comes on a, you know, on a very like clear cognitive level. It just feels through the energy and that's it. And I know that this person can get it in an hour. Set with it, if they gave it the intention and the time to show up and to show them the lesson, an hour is all would it take them. Wow. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Stuff.
Right. These things can happen that quickly now, that the energies support that. And they didn't really before.
Yeah.
Not for the majority of people. There's a lot of people who are catching up. Katya, this has been so enjoyable. Will you come back? Can we do this again sometime? Can we maybe do this on a more regular basis?
Totally. Yes, totally. We can totally.
Loved it.
A lot to share.
Yeah, loved it. So much fun. That we have a lot to talk about. Well, I suspect next time I talk to you, your family will be a little larger and you'll have some more stories to tell us. And you and I are going to talk about creating that workshop coming up, but for right now, I think we're going to go ahead and conclude our time together today. So you can find Katya and her work at indigodiaries.com, and you can subscribe to her active blog. She has a YouTube channel, a Facebook page, and all those things. She discusses topics like spiritual empowerment, motherhood, parenting, and education of the new paradigm, energy conscious branding and businesses, and so much more. Katya, thank you again for joining us today. And I look forward to chatting with you and your wonderful husband, Cherokee, very soon in the future.
Yes.
Say hi to him for me and give your baby a kiss. And we'll talk to you later.
Definitely. Thank you for having me.
Happy 2017, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.